Hello everyone, thanks for watching yet another video where I am working on restoring or resurrecting one of these Pioneer CTF-900 cassette decks from 1978-1979. So the deck that you're looking at here came in pretty bad shape, and I'll talk about that in a few minutes. I'll go through some of the details. This particular deck had really more superficial issues than electronic issues. They all have the same problem with the transport, and we'll talk about that. They all have the same problem with old motors, especially the rewind and take-up reel motor that has to be worked on. So we'll go through the work that I performed in this particular deck. The recapping has been limited only to the power supply and the control board, and I'll talk a little bit about why I did that. So we're going to go ahead and get into this video and talk more about what's been done to this deck. But first, we'll go ahead and turn it on and start a recording so that you can hear how it sounds. It's remarkable for its age. So the test tape I typically use to record on, and we go through a series of these, as you know, if you've watched these videos, is I have just a basic cassette tape. This is a normal position cassette tape. I've turned the play and record timer starts off. So we'll just turn the unit on and we'll talk about the unit a little bit. Now, this particular unit did not need some of the same kinds of upgrades or work that I had done on some of the older decks. If you've watched these videos, and I hope that you go back and watch as many of them as you can so you can get some perspective, what I typically do is replace the pinch rollers. Well, on this deck, the pinch rollers were in remarkably good condition, and you really have to look at them, because if they're cracked, then they're no good. If there are micro cracks in it, you know, and I look at them very close up with an ocular, if there are small cracks, striations, then I go ahead and replace them. But these quite frankly just needed to be cleaned, and I used a product that I've been using on occasion. It depends. It really depends on what I have to do. This is not a product placement. Nobody's paying me to show this, but I actually use this on occasion to clean pinch rollers, not belts, just the pinch rollers, and see if I can rejuvenate them. If I can, I'll use them. If I cannot, I will replace them. Well, these cleaned up fairly nicely. So what that also meant was I did not have to remove this nut, which has to do with the height adjustment here. And this is a very important adjustment that has to do with tracking on the tape. So I did not have to do that. What I did do after I cleaned those two pinch rollers was certainly I did an azimuth adjustment using an oscilloscope, and then I marked those. Now, as we look at this deck, I will take you into the deck itself. This, something had happened in its lifetime where apparently some water may have gotten into it in the back of it and incurred some rust. I've taken care of that and I've fixed that. But the bonnet, that's the cover that goes over, that's what they call it in the Pioneer guide. The bonnet was pretty badly rusted at some point, pretty pitted. So I have completely cleaned that up and primed and painted that. So that's done. So what we're going to do first is we're going to go into the YouTube library. We're going to record a little bit of a session here, let you hear what this sounds like. This is a remarkable deck. Remember, 1978 was when this deck was brand new. So what we will listen to first is from the YouTube library. It's called Smokey's Lounge. I'm just going to go ahead and get this started recording. And before I do, I'm going to point out a few things. First, this is not ferrochrome. So you have A standard tape. This is the most basic tape that you can buy. And it is it on these decks, this automatically senses what kind of tape is in the deck. So if you notice this sensor here, this is actually looking for a little cutout in the top. And of course, on a chrome tape, a type 2 tape, which we're going to look at where my thumb is, there's a little cutout there. Well, this one does not have a cutout, and no normal bias tapes did. And so it's going to look like a normal tape or the old style ferrochrome tapes. The ferrochrome tapes stopped being manufactured. I think Sony was the last to manufacture a ferrochrome tape. And if you look at the ferrochrome tape, you'll see there is no notch in it, right? So you only have the read write notch, but you don't have the notch that's supposed to tell the unit that it's a chrome tape. So you would have to manually select ferrochrome. And that's why that light lights up. And that's why I've turned it off, because I'm not using a ferrochrome tape. Now, I don't have the front panel on it. You know, I always start these without it. But when I put the front panel on, what you would see is that this is the bias fine adjustment. This is the ferrochrome override. A few other things. This is the tape, the sound that's coming from the tape as it's being recorded, and the source. Now, remember, I know that folks have seen many of these recordings, but I'll just sort of clarify or reclarify. This is a three-head deck. So if you look at this side, this is the record head, this is the playback head, and they're all encapsulated in one package. So there's an erase head, there's a record head, and there's a play head. So when you have this set to tape, as the recording is made, the playback head is listening to it and playing it back for you. And that's what we're going to hear when we play Smokey's Lounge. So I'm going to start Smokey's Lounge just so you can see on source. Now this is whatever's playing, not what's being recorded. So let's go ahead and play that. Okay. So nothing's being recorded on the tape at the moment. Now we're going to start recording. A couple things to notice. I do have Dolby turned on. That's this switch. And you'll hear a difference when we play it back. Listen for the highs. Now, when we were recording, we weren't actually hearing the music being recorded onto the tape, but now we will. If we use the bias fine adjustment, we can sometimes tune how that sounds. So let's do that. Turning to the left really brightens it. Did you hear the difference? Going to the right seems to be as if you've turned the treble down. Going to the left, adjust the bias for this particular tape brand. So now we'll go ahead and play it back and see how that sounds. Now, because we're at counter 20 and I didn't set this to go back to zero, I'm going to tell it to end or replay at the counter. This is the repeat set to counter 0. So when it hits 0, it's going to start playing again. The bias fine adjustment has no effect on playback, only on record. Dolby is in. If I take it out, you can hear the highs will be more pronounced. And remember, I stopped and I started again. This is the section where I had started again. And now you're going to hear me work with the bias fine adjustment. There you go. Hear it? It's like somebody turned the treble up. Now, as I've been recording and playing, I've been turning this knob. Now, this is the knob that has to do with input, and this will govern what is actually recorded on the tape in terms of the volume that's recorded on the tape. This, however, is the actual output of the deck to the amplifier. So this, I can turn this all the way down, I can turn it all the way up, and it's not going to affect the recording. However, what it does affect is what you see in the view meter, this VU meter. It's a visual unit meter that shows how much is actually being recorded on the tape. And for those of you who may not be familiar, because you maybe haven't worked with a mechanical means of recording sound, these are rated in decibels from negative 20 to plus 7. And your objective is on a typical tape to land anywhere between maybe 7, 3, or 5. The higher you go, possibly the more distorted you get. The lower you go, the better your dynamic range may be, where your frequency range may be higher. But the lower you go, the more the hiss from the tape passing across the record playback head increases. So it's a bit of a trade-off. You have to go sort of for the best of both. And that's one of the reasons you have a bias control, and that's why you can control your volume as you are recording. So we've just talked about a recording with a what we call a standard tape. And I wanted to do that with the face plate off, just so I could illustrate, talk to you a little bit about some of the workings, how it actually performs. But what we're going to do is, for our other demonstrations, which will be on a chrome tape and a ferrochrome tape, I'll put the face plate back on because I think it's more important for you to see how the unit's going to function as, you know, after you buy it. Because again, I'm putting these videos together not only to show that I've resurrected these, but also to sell them. I want to bring them in, fix them, and I'd like to get them off my desk and out of my inventory as soon as I can. All right, so again, I did not replace, I reconditioned the pinch rollers. They're in great shape. I did put a new belt, a set of new belts on, and I did rebuild the motor. Now I'm going to go off tripod, and I'm going to take you on a tour through the inside of the deck so we can talk about what happened there. So off tripod now, we're going to take a quick view. First, I want you to see exactly what this looks like. Now, I have been doing many, many tests with this, so I'll clean the pinch rollers before I ship the deck. But the record playback pinch rollers, good shape. I always rebuild the rewind motor. When I say rebuild it, I take it apart. I clean all of the parts inside, which means there is a governor that has two switches. I clean those, and I clean the armature. And then I grease it, and I put it back together. Then I test it. This is working exceptionally. Now, while you can't see it very well down there, you see there are two belts. There's one for the main capstan, and then the one for the feed capstan. And you also see, I'm not sure if I can easily point out, do you see this little wire? Okay, this wire is very important. It actually is a static relieving wire. So this is the chassis, so that's ground. But what happens, because you got rubber, what happens is on the physical components of the tape deck, they can build up static electricity. And what this does is it relieves that static electricity by sending it to ground, and that's what that wire is for. If you open up one of these and find out you don't have it, somebody's been in there, they've been messing around, should have it. Okay, so let's turn our attention to the control board. Now, this control board is in pretty good shape. These capacitors, notice the red ones, I've switched most of my capacitors, same brand now. These are exceptional. I think I have maybe one or two of the older brand. They're all fine, but the red ones are very good. This has been recapped. No other changes were made to this board, except there was a service campaign that affected how the playback and rewind works. I'll talk about that later. So I've implemented that service campaign. Now, if we look back here, this is your power supply. And it looks a whole lot different from the way it did before, because what you have now are you have brand new capacitors. Every capacitor on this board has been replaced with brand new Nichicon or better capacitors. I've also measured the outputs from all of the legs that actually put power out. Those are perfectly within spec. Now, when I got this unit, I could tell something had happened, maybe with some water. And if you look at this deck when you buy it, you'll notice that, see, and I think even on the video, you can see there's the chassis and then there's some gold. All right, this was all rusted back here. I think water had come in through the top and rusted this very back. So what I did was I primed it, I sanded it, cleaned it, primed it down, I took the transformer out to do that, and then I painted it with black Rust-Oleum, and then on top of the black Rust-Oleum, I just put some gold Rust-Oleum just so that it would sort of match. So that's been cleaned up. Now, the motherboard. So something I always do with the motherboard, and you know this from watching my other videos, is I take these switches apart. Okay? This is the one with Dolby. This is the one you'll get most of your issues with. If this is not clean, you may not get a decent recording. This one is for the microphone switch. If you're going to use microphones, it's been cleaned. It works. The microphones are clean. This is the source versus the tape. So if this one's depressed, this one automatically releases. So you're listening to source or tape. Both of these get cleaned, because if they're not clean, then then occasionally you'll get a distorted or scratchy sound. Let's see. You also, of course, I always clean all of the buttons. So this one, I have to tell you, these buttons were a challenge. Now remember, if you look at these buttons, they're plastic. Well, that one in the middle isn't. That's actually machined aluminum. But these are plastic that have been chromed. These are plastic that have been chromed. Now you can shine them up. You can take the oxide off of them and shine them up, which is what I've done, and it's about as good as I can get. The faceplate, that lens, I always take it apart, clean everything, and I usually polish up the lens. This one was really scratched. I don't know why, but it's in good shape now. And any of the aluminum knobs, you know, I'll clean them up as best I can. So the unit itself is in pretty good shape, but I want to be clear about this. The control board, you always want to recap. And if you're having trouble, that's where you stop and you fix other issues with the control board. You could have a bad transistor or something like that. With the power supply, you always recap the power supply. I did some of my early ones that I refurbished. I didn't do that. The good news is almost every capacitor that I pulled out and I keep, you know, I throw them in a bin, almost every capacitor on the power board that I took off were in spec. And I mean, really very close to spec. You know, if it says it's a 1,000 microfarad, it was maybe 1,021. So it was in good shape. ESR was perfectly in line. So what I took out looked pretty good, but you know, they're 50 years old, and a 50-year-old capacitor is not a capacitor you want to leave on your power supply. So, in review, that's the major electronic work that was done. The major mechanical work, of course, when I take these things apart, they get new belts, they get new tires. This tire, in fact, the one that you see right here, that tire has to be replaced and the tension spring has to be readjusted. Otherwise, it's not going to take up properly or rewind properly. You have to rip you really I don't know what other people are doing. If you look at this deck and you think, well, it's way too expensive for me, I'm just going to get something cheaper. Well, go ahead. And when that stops working, well, okay, sorry. Mine has been rebuilt. It's going to work for another 50 years. This is in great shape. So let's see, what else? I never recap the control board for the display unless I have to take the display apart. There are occasions, there's a PDP 4001, I think, microprocessor on that. And if it goes out or there's a problem with the display or the counter's not working, I have to take it apart, then I'll recap the whole thing. But generally speaking, I don't do that. The motherboard in this situation, based on all of the testing that I did and the calibration that I did, it's in fine shape, which means I left those capacitors as they are. And there may be people who look at this and go, well, you should have recapped the whole thing. I have recapped entire motherboards and found to be no difference. And in fact, as I take capacitors out, I always measure them. Just wondering, hey, you know, did I pull a capacitor that's really bad as I'm putting a new one? Because if you pull one, you might as well just put a new one in, right? So when I'm doing that, I'll put them through the little M tester and I'll look at what their rating is. And for the most part, they're almost always very, very close to a brand new capacitor. Their ESR is almost always very close. There are occasions when it isn't, but when those occasions occur, I've also had other issues recording and playing back. So there's usually been a reason that I have gone at the motherboard to recap it. And this one works fine. No need to do it. All right, so I've shown you that. Let me show you the bonnet just so you can see a little bit about it. So I'm still off tripod. I've put the faceplate on. And I've also put the bonnet on. So this will give me a chance to go over any of the defects that you might see on the unit. Notice that the corners are in pretty good condition. There are very few scratches along the face of the unit. Corners are a big thing with these. A lot of them are bent in or damaged. There is a little bit of some of the lettering where it says source has rubbed off. I think somebody was really aggressive, it was not me, on trying to clean it. Here are your polished controls as best I could. You see the tape path looks pretty good. I will clean those pinch rollers one last time before I ship it. The lens is in exceptional condition. Really nice bright display. I did the best I could to polish up those switches. They look pretty good. And now to the bonnet or the case top. Notice there is a little bit of texture. That's because that's where it was pretty badly rusted. So I cleaned all of that up, primed it, and then spray painted with a primer, and then of course spray painted with black matte. So you can see it looks pretty good. I mean, I have to say the way it looked before was pretty bad. This looks really, really exceptional. Okay. So now we're going to continue with the deck performance so that you know how it works. We'll go back on tripod for that. Okay, we're back to doing some testing. Now remember, I had recorded and played a standard tape. This is position normal. You would not see a CR2 indicator or FECR indicator lighting up, nothing like that. We did play with Dolby. We recorded with Dolby and then we played back with Dolby. Now what we're going to do is we're going to record and play on a ferrochrome tape. Now, why am I doing a ferrochrome tape? Well, because this works with ferrochrome tapes if you have them. And you might have ferrochrome tapes. You can still buy them used, and occasionally you'll find new ones on eBay. And there are people who swear by them, so I'm certainly not going to discount them. But what I'm going to show you is how it works. So ferrochrome tape, which is a Type 3 tape, they didn't live very long. They went out of production. I think Sony was the last to make them in 1985. It's a combination of the best that you could get from a chromium dioxide tape and the best that you could get from a standard tape. These will sound warmer. So we're going to go ahead and now notice when I put that tape in, the automatic tape indicator, I didn't know what it is because it's a ferrochrome tape. So you have to set it because this says auto CR02. So it's standard or FECR. So this is now set for ferrochrome. Now we're going to record on a ferrochrome tape. Now, remember I talked to you about ferrochrome tapes. They were in production up until about 1985 when Sony stopped making them. You can still get them. These tend to sound a little warmer. They're a combination of the normal tape plus a chromium dioxide tape. Chromium dioxide tapes came out in the 1970s, and it was a different formulation which had higher output, also had a wider range. So this was sort of the best of both worlds. You can still get them. Of course, you get them used or occasionally you'll find some new old stock. Now, notice when I put the tape in, it did not automatically set the indicator. That's because, remember, that doesn't have a notch on it. So we will set it here. We'll also turn Dolby on. And what I want to do is get my levels straight because I did record this earlier and it was distorting. So I'm going to go ahead and set my levels. Right now, I've got my volume output all the way up. I've got tape monitor. I'm going to put this on source. There we go. And that's pretty high, if you'll notice. So I'm going to put this on average. I'm going to bring it back a little bit. There we go. All right. Close to 5. We're going to go ahead and try that and see how that sounds on a recording. So, reset. I have the counter restart ready to go. I'm going to go ahead and start recording. Sounds a little dull to me, so I'm going to turn the bias to encourage it to be a little brighter. All right, we're going to play that back, see how that sounds. Here it is. Not a lot of highs. I've adjusted the bias during the recording. Comes in about now. Better. Now you can always turn Dolby off on playback. That'll bring your highs out because of course Dolby boosts the highs when the recording is taking place. Pretty good. Okay, now we're going to do a chromium dioxide or a cobalt treated tape. Now, again, there are many different manufacturers of these. I happen to be using a Radio Shack tape. I believe Maxell was actually making the tape media for them at the time. So each tape will react a little differently with the deck. Note that you can't use a metal tape when recording on this deck. The CTF950 brought metal recording capability to this line of decks. However, you could play back a metal tape. The reason you can't record a metal tape is it requires a completely different erase head with a higher amount of current and a different bias that has to be applied to the tape. So the CTF 900s could not record on a metal tape. You would always play back a metal tape because you're not attempting to alter it, but you can't record it with this deck. But you can record the chromium dioxide. You can certainly record the other two types that we looked at. So we're going to go ahead and do one of these. So this one we're going to reset. And because it's a chromium dioxide tape, I might be able to sneak a little more headroom out of it. So I'm just going to put it up a little higher to 5. We'll see what happens. Note, it doesn't matter how this is set. Why is that? Because it automatically selects based on that knockout there, right? Okay. Oh, and by the way, this is important too. Notice every time I put this in, it sort of does a little bit of a rewind. That's a retensioning. That's by design. It's supposed to do that. So let's go ahead and do Smokey's Lounge again. I've reset the counter. I've set the repeat counter so that it will rewind and start playing. We're going to be monitoring the tape. I have Dolby in. This doesn't matter because of the notch. I have my bias set as it is in the middle. And I've put the volume up a little bit. So let's go ahead and start recording and play Smokey's Lounge. Let's see how bias works on this one. Dull to the right. skinny or more treble to the left. I'm going to put it back to the middle. Let's see how that sounds. Pretty good. This is about to be adjusted when I'm recorded. You can always pull Dolby out. Sounds pretty good. So let's talk about some of the other features of the deck. So what we're looking at as we're recording or playing things, you've got, let's see, let me go ahead and play something else here. As I said before, remember the output, I am recording, but the output does affect the view meter, so you could get a little confused about that. When you have monitor on source, that is what you use to adjust your input. When you're playing back, this is actually being played back through the preamplifier section of the deck, so that's why these are lower. Now, you have different capabilities on this deck. You have something called a timer start. If I set it to play, what will happen is when I just start the unit from power off, it will actually start and start playing. Now this was before we had other kinds of devices. There was a timer, a manual timer that actually you could purchase with this, and it would actually turn the unit on. When the unit turns on, if the play is set, then it'll just go ahead and start playing. See? Now, also, you had something called a record start. Now, that was very important because people in the 70s and the early 80s didn't have the same kind of time shifting we have today with, what we ended up having with VCRs. So this is sort of a time shift for maybe an FM broadcast. So you would set your FM dial to whatever the station was. You would set your timer to whatever time that station was supposed to be playing whatever that broadcast was. And you would then turn on your receiver and your tape deck at the same time to record whatever was on the airwaves. And that's what's happening here. I turned it on, I had this set to record, and it starts recording whatever is playing into the unit. Fancy for the time. A few other things. I'm going to just turn that off because one thing you do want to do is make sure that you don't have timer start set and you haven't taken your read write notches out. We have a meter. Now this meter has average. It has something called peak hold, and you'll see that in a minute. Peak hold just shows the top. See, it holds the highest segment that it has heard to that point in time. Using that can help you make sure that you're not recording too high on a tape, which would lead to distortion. And then there was just regular peak. Peak and average kind of look the same, but average flows a little more than peak does. Peak tends to be a little more jittery. Okay, Then you had your memory and repeat function. So memory, you can set it to stop or play at counter zero. You can also have it repeat at counter zero or at the end of the tape. So I can set this to the end of the tape, and I'll pause for a second until it gets to the end. It's approaching the end, but you can also hear how quiet the mechanism is. At the end, with this depressed for repeat, it will just go ahead and start playing again. Now, what's handy about that is this is not, remember, this is not an auto reverse cassette deck. This only plays in one direction. So what you could do is you could set it up so that when it reaches the end of the tape, as it might in this situation, when it reaches the end of the tape, instead of just stopping and you have to rewind the tape and play it again, it will automatically rewind the tape and play that side over and over again. And it's not your auto reverse, which came along a little later than these decks, but it at least gives you the ability to continue to play one side over and over without having to get up and rewind it. And the other nice feature, in fact, it's a feature that was lost on decks after this to a great degree, was the whole notion of, well, I'm somewhere in the middle of the tape, I want to go ahead and rewind it and start playing from the beginning. And many decks didn't even have that. Or if they had it, it was sort of hidden. You had to hit the rewind and play at the same time, and then maybe it would program itself to do that. So there were some interesting features on these decks. So that takes you through the features. You've heard some recordings. What you should also have heard is that the WoW and Flutter seems to sound pretty good on this particular deck. It's tracking a little higher than the spec was, but it's pretty much inaudible. Now I'm going to go ahead and show you the back of the deck so that when you do make the selection to purchase this on eBay, that you know that what you saw is, in fact, the very deck. So I am going to, while we're on camera, just go ahead and turn this around. Actually, let me turn it this way. So this deck is, and I have to look at it from a sort of a sideways view. This is chrome. So it's a YK3623644. That's the serial number. There are a couple of stickers on it. This is the QA sticker. These are all the tests that I run. And then there's a service repair record that tells you what I did to the unit. They're both removable. They're just removable stickers. So at this point, I think you've seen everything that I could possibly disclose about the unit. These are for sale on eBay. They are guaranteed not dead on arrival. However, I'm very clear about this. If the box looks as if it has been rolled over, if there is obvious damage to the box itself, I ask that you refuse the shipment so that it comes back to me, and I can then take up, I usually ship these with UPS, and I can take it up with UPS for damage and freight. If it is damaged, but the box looks good and it does not work, then it's returnable. You know, I will take it back. I will not take it back if you didn't like it, or you saw something that you didn't see on the videos and the pictures, which I try to make sure are all in full disclosure. You know, I really want to make sure that you pay very clear attention to everything. Ask all the questions you could possibly ask. I will be happy to give you more detailed pictures of the unit. I'll be happy to do anything I can to help you make sure it is the unit that you want. But I'm not Amazon.com, so you can't just, you know, order it and if you don't like it, return it. That's not the way I work. I can't do that. I also can't, if this thing stops working in 6 months, I can't really do much about that. I can't guarantee it's going to work for another 40 years, right, or 50 years. What I can tell you is I've replaced all of the parts that would have normally been a problem on these units. So again, CTF-900, three-head stereo cassette deck, built by Pioneer in the late 1970s. This had a 1978 stamp on the motor. For sale on eBay. I hope that this has answered all the questions you might have. If not, please make them in the comments and I'll try to do my best to answer them. Thank you.